إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. All praise is due to Allah. We praise Him and seek His assistance. We seek refuge with Allah from the evil within ourselves and from the evil of our deeds. Whomsoever Allah guides, none can misguide him. Yet whomever he allows to go astray, none can guide him. And I bear witness that there is no God worthy of worship except Allah alone. He has no partner, and I bear witness that Muhammad is his servant and his messenger. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu attaqullaha haqqa tuqatihi wa la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun. O you who believe, fear Allah as he should be feared, and do not die except in the state of Islam. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. O you who believe, fear Allah and speak the truth. He will direct you to do righteous good deeds and will forgive your sins. And whomsoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, he has indeed achieved a great achievement. أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Brothers and sisters in Islam, today our khutbah is about patience. And we begin with a story that happened in Little Rock, Arkansas about 2 years ago. A grandmother was on her way to the mall and she stopped at a stop sign and she took a little bit too long. So the man in the car behind her got impatient. He took out his gun and he just fired in the direction of her car. And she didn't really hear or register the gunshot. And she continued, and when she arrived to the mall, she had a toddler that was in the back seat. When she arrived to the mall, he was dead. And they mentioned that this was the second fatality, second incident due to someone's impatience in that same exact month. And we noticed this, when you stop at a red light, and when it turns green, if you delay just 2 seconds, the car behind you honks. Just 2 seconds. Or you see all kinds of signs of impatience. When you press the elevator button, it lights up. And then a few seconds later, you press it again. As if that's how the mechanism works. It will not make it come any faster. But just look at the impatience in our lives. There was a huge study conducted using 6.7 million internet users. And they found that the majority of people will abandon an online video if it takes more than 2 seconds to load. And look at our level of impatience. If it takes more than 2 seconds, the majority of people will abandon a video. Another study showed that the majority of people only read 20% of the material on a page. And sometimes people don't link reading with patience. But the inability to read an entire article, that's actually lack of patience. Most people read just 20% of the material on a page. 1 in 4 will abandon a page if it takes more than 4 seconds to load. Yani 25% of people, if the page takes more than 4 seconds, they will abandon it. And if it takes more than 10 seconds, 50% of the people will leave. Amazon estimates that they stand to lose about $1.6 billion per year due to 1 second delays on their page. Just 1 second. So we're in the age and in the world of instant gratification. And everything is getting faster and faster. And because things are only getting faster, nothing is helping us become more patient. USA Today reported that the majority of Americans will not wait in line longer than 15 minutes. Half of them said they would never return to an establishment that made them wait. Not because the food was bad, they just had to wait. The problem with this is that it translates into other areas of our life. It will translate into how we deal with one another, and it will translate into how we deal with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 1 in 5 people admitted to being rude to someone who was slow when serving them. So you're going to be rude to another human being just because they were slow. And they served you in the end, but you're being rude to them just because they were slow. And it translates into our acts of worship. Because then people who are used to things happening quickly, they don't have the patience to ask Allah Azza wa Jal. And when you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're supposed to persist and persevere. Ask constantly, over and over and over again. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told us what happens when you're in a rush for your dua to be answered. You put yourself at risk of not having your dua answered at all. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in the Sahih in Bukhari and Muslim, and Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says that yustajabu li ahadikum ma lam ya'jal. Your dua will be responded to so long as you don't rush it. يَقُولُ قَدْ دَعَوْتُ رَبِّي فَلَمْ يُسْتَجَبْ لِي. I called upon my Lord and he didn't answer me. This person is rushing it. And he wants to make dua and find the package next to him immediately when he's done with making dua. But the Prophet ﷺ said that you will be responded to so long as you don't rush it like that. So you put yourself at risk of not even having your dua answered. But the point is that people are so impatient, they don't have the patience to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the necessary patience, the persistence and the perseverance. When we need something from Allah azza wa jal, we find the best times. You wake up in the last third of the night. You fast, because when you break your fast, there's a dua that will not be refused. People taking advantage of these times and constantly coming back to Allah azza wa jal and asking Him. That requires a lot of patience. But due to this impatience, people now try to find shortcuts. And you'll see this more overseas, where people try to find a magical formula to make their thing happen. Someone will say, if you recite Al-Fatiha 1,000 times in a night, whatever you ask for will happen. And if there's a dua, if you do this, this will happen. If you do that magical formula, that thing will happen. An imam we met in Trinidad, he said a man came to him and he said, give me a dua to make me patient because I don't want to wait for it. Yeah, and even in his question, he's showing impatience. He just magically wants it to happen because he doesn't want to wait for it. But brothers and sisters, the truth is, patience, being patient is difficult. And the proof that it's difficult is that its reward is great. The scholar said, when the reward is great, that means the action itself is something that is difficult. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Az-Zumar says, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرُهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Those who are patient, they will get the reward without hisab. So what does it mean without hisab? Some of the mufassirin, some of the scholars said, بِغَيْرِ حَدٍّ وَلَا عَدٍّ وَلَا مِقْدَارٍ. Meaning, without any counting, without any specific measurement. Imam al-Awza'i rahimahullah, he said, لَيْسَ يُوزًا لَهُمْ وَلَا يُكَالْ إِنَّمَا يُغْرَفُ لَهُمْ غَرْفًا. He said, their reward will not be weighed and it will not be measured, but they will just be given in scoop after scoop of reward because they were patient. The reward is great because the action was difficult. Other mufassirin said it means they will not be held to account in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No scales will be brought forth. Their deeds will not be weighed. And this is a moment that no one is looking forward to. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you stand in front of Allah azza wa jal, and He will ask you, and the Prophet ﷺ said, لَيْسَ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَهُ تُرْجُمَانٌ. With no translator between you and Allah Azza wa Jal. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will go through your records and ask you about sins and mistakes. No one is looking forward to that. But the patient, they don't have to go through that. Their deeds will not be weighed, they will not be asked, they will get the reward without being held accountable. So in this explanation, بِغَيْرِ حِسَاب, يعني, without them being held accountable in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Great reward, because the action itself was great and it was difficult. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا يَزَالُ الْبَلَاءُ بِالْمُؤْمِنِ وَالْمُؤْمِنَةِ فِي نَفْسِهِ وَوَلَدِهِ وَمَالِهِ حَتَّى يَلْقَ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى وَمَا عَلَيْهِ خَطِيئًا. He said that the trial, the difficulty, the test will continue to be upon the believing man or the believing woman in themselves, could be their health, them personally, وَوَلَدِهِ, and in their children, and in their wealth, until they meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they have no sin on them whatsoever. Meaning these difficulties expiate the sins and remove the sins. And that's why Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he used to say, لَوْلَا الْمَصَائِبْ لَقَدِمْنَا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ مَفَالِيسِ. He used to say, had it not been for the calamities, we would come forth bankrupt on the Day of Judgment, with nothing. But these calamities, they remove so many of sins. So we see that because the act was difficult, the reward was great. As-sabr, linguistically in the lugha, بمعنى الحبس, يعني it means to contain or to imprison. And because it's difficult, we don't like to be told to be patient. We don't like when the solution is patience. When someone goes to an imam and they list their problem and they speak to him for an hour, telling them, detailing their problem, then the imam at the end just says, be patient, inshallah. They become so angered because they feel it's a cop-out. this imam doesn't know enough about psychology. He doesn't know enough to give me practical steps. So he just throws this whole be patient thing on me because he doesn't know anything else to say. But brothers and sisters, many times there are problems where the solution is only patience and there's nothing else. Yani someone's loved one passes away. The only solution is patience. There's no formula here that will make things better. All kinds of things. Yani. So the solution is just patience. And we see this in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will highlight a problem and then just mention patience as the solution. Because sometimes that's the only solution. This happens in Surah Al-A'raf. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقَالَ الْمَلَأُ مِنْ قَوْمِ فِرْعَوْنِ أَتَذَرُ مُوسَى وَقَوْمَهُ لِيُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَيَذَرَكَ وَآلِهَتَكَ قَالَ سَنُقَتِّلُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ وَنَسْتَحِي نِسَاءَهُمْ وَإِنَّا فَوْقَهُمْ قَاهِرُونَ. The leaders and the mala, the people around Fir'aun, the leaders around the Pharaoh, they said, are you going to allow Musa and his people to make mischief in the land and abandon you and your gods? So he, Fir'aun, responds, we will kill their sons and spare their women, and we indeed surely have power over them. That's verse 127. Next verse is the response of Musa. قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ إِسْتَعِينُوا بِاللَّهِ وَاصْبِرُوا. That's it. That's the solution. They don't have anything else. They don't have power. They don't have an army. They don't have arms. So Musa alayhi salam said to his people, just seek the assistance of Allah and be patient. So sometimes patience is the only answer. So we shouldn't hate the idea of being told to be patient because it's the only solution. But it's a solution that if we took it seriously, it would solve so many of our problems. This story, this speaker, he said, I was sitting at the masjid and this sheikh was giving a talk. And then after the lecture, I was sitting with the sheikh speaking, and then a young man came and he looked like he had the weight of the world on his shoulders. So the young man approached this older sheikh and he tells him, ya sheikh, I have a problem. He says, I just don't love my wife. So the sheikh said, did she do anything wrong? Is there anything wrong with her? He said, she doesn't do anything wrong. There's nothing wrong with her. I just don't love her. The sheikh tells him, go home and be patient with your wife. So this young speaker said, I thought to myself, yani, how is this good advice to give a young man? Yani, we're used to practical steps. Step one, roses. Step two, chocolate. We like steps like that. But he told him, go home and be patient. He said, then time passed, maybe a year or two. And then I was giving a lecture and that young man came to me. And he said, do you remember me? Then he reminded me of the incident. I said, yes, speaking of that, what happened between you and your wife? He said, I took the sheikh's advice to heart. The first thing is, this is a rare type of young man. Yani, a young man, you tell him, just be patient, and that's all he does. He takes it seriously. He says, I took the sheikh's advice to heart. And I went home, and I started to be patient with my wife. He said, then within a short period of time, within no time, I became so madly in love with her that from work I would call her. And she would say, what do you want? And I would say, nothing. Just to hear your voice. Patience is something that we need to acquire because we're going to be tested, no doubt. In Surah Al-Ankabut, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alif Lam Mim, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do people think just because they say we believe that they're not going to be tested and they're going to be left alone? Yeah, and it's a rhetorical question. It's saying that you will be tested. You are going to be tested by Allah Azza wa Jal. Likewise in Surah Al-Insan, إِنَّ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ مِن نُطْفَةٍ أَمْشَاجٍ نَبْتَلِيهِ فَجَعَلْنَاهُ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. So we're seeing even here that we're going to be tested. If we know we're going to be tested, then definitely we're going to need to be patient with the tests. And if you're patient, nothing will change. And if you're not patient, nothing will change, or it could get worse. So we're either patient upon the decree of Allah Azza wa Jal, and nothing will change, and you get reward. Or you will not be patient, and nothing will change, and you get no reward. Yani, someone's child dies. So he says, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Will the child come back? He's patient, but the child didn't come back, but they got reward. The other person, their child dies. They're not patient. They scream, and they break the furniture and everything. Will the child come back? No. What's the difference between the two situations? One of them, the person was patient and got reward. And the other, he wasn't patient and nothing changed. It's still the same outcome in the end. But it's about getting reward with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ. يعني the situation of the believer is, يعني it's amazing. إِنَّ أَمْرُهُ كُلَّهُ خَيْرٌ لَهُ خَيْرٌ. يعني all his situations will be good for him. وَلَيْسَ ذَلِكَ لِأَحَدٍ إِلَّا الْمُؤْمِنِ. And that's not for anyone except for the believer. إِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ سَرَّاءُ شَكَرٌ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ. If something good happens, he thanks Allah, and that will be good for them. وَإِنْ أَصَابَتْهُ ضَرَّاءُ. And if something bad happens, صَبَرْ فَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُ. Something bad happens, they'll be patient, and then it will be good for them. We all know Uthman ibn Affan رضي الله عنه. But the scholar said, why was his father given this nickname? His father's name, يعني his nickname was Affan. Why was he given that nickname? They said, لَأَنَّهُ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. During the time of Jahiliyyah, before Islam, عَفَّعًا, he imprisoned himself, contained his, imprisoned his desire against women and wine. So even though he could have, but he stopped himself from that. So they called him Affan. And in Surah An-Nur, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning getting married and allowing people to get married and encouraging marriage. And then he says, وَلْيَسْتَعْفِفَ الَّذِينَ لَا يَجِدُونَ نِكَاحًا حَتَّى يُغْنِيَهُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. As for those who are incapable, they don't have any of the monetary measures to get married, then let them يستعففوا, يعني let them hold back their desire and keep themselves chaste. But then what's beautiful, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, حَتَّى يُغْنِيَهُمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. So they're keeping themselves chaste until Allah gets them married? No. Until Allah gives them wealth? No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, until Allah gives them from His bounties. Not just gives them what they're missing, but gives them more. And so the scholars said, لَأَنَّهُ مَنْ عَفَّ عَنِ الْحَرَامِ أَعْطَاهُ اللَّهُ الْحَلَالِ وَضِعْفَهُ. Whoever stops himself from the haram, Allah will give them from the halal and multiply that further. And that's why the verse didn't say He'll just help them get married or He'll help them have the wealth to get married, but He will just keep giving them from His bounties. That is from the results and from the fruits of being patient. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ الْعَظِيمَ لِي وَلَكُمْ من جميع الذنوب فاستغفروه فيا فوز المستغفرين. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His forgiveness. Indeed, those who ask for His forgiveness shall prosper. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الأمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد. So the question then becomes, how can one become patient? And what are the things that help us become more patient? And the first thing is, through practicing being patient. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in Sahih al-Jami', he said, إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ بِالتَّعَلُّمِ. And if you want to become knowledgeable, you do that through constantly learning. إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ بِالتَّعَلُّمِ وَإِنَّمَا الْحِلْمُ بِالتَّحَلُّمِ. And to be forbearing, to be able to contain your anger, you need to do that by constantly containing your anger. It's through practice. And so being patient is not through a dua or some magical formula, but it's through training yourself to be patient. The second thing is that when someone recognizes that these calamities draw them closer to Allah, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala afflicted them so they can get nearer to Him, then that makes it easier to bear through any kind of calamity. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَن يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُصِبْ مِنْهُ. Whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants good from them, He afflicts them, He tests them with something in their life. And in another famous hadith, وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى إِذَا أَحَبَّ قَوْمًا إِبْتَلَاهُمْ. And indeed, if Allah loves a people, He will test them. And so someone might say, what kind of love is this? If Allah loves me, He will test me with difficulty. But the truth is, the way we make dua to Allah Azza wa Jal during time of difficulty is not like when everything is okay. The way we pray to Allah Azza wa Jal during time of difficulty is not like when everything is okay. And so if Allah, and the whole point is when Allah loves you, that you become closer to Him. And nothing guarantees that more than when you have a problem or a calamity. You will immediately rush to Allah Azza wa Jal. We mentioned this story of this man. He said he had a personal calamity. So he would wake up for Qiyam for a year or a year and a half. Every single night he'd wake up for Qiyam. Which also means he never missed Isha and never missed Fajr, because he's always waking up for Qiyam. He said, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fixed all my problems. And he said, for 9 years, I've never gotten up for Qiyam again. And I've constantly missed Fajr. Yani the point is, when he had difficulty, what happened? The result is what was intended. He got close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when Allah is testing you, He's bringing you nearer to Him. And when you're aware of that, then it decreases from that difficulty and it helps you become patient. The second thing is that it increases the individual in rank. That Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam mentions in Sahih that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala might decree a level for you in Al-Jannah. And with your deeds, you fall short of reaching that level. Yani Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala decreed this person will be in this level in Al-Jannah, but their work will only get them to a lower level. How does Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala get them to that higher level? He will test them with difficulty. And then the beautiful thing of the hadith that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, ثُمَّ صَبَّرَهُ عَلَى ذَلِكَ. Then Allah will aid him in being patient upon that. And then he will reach that level that was written for him. The third is that difficulties expiate sins. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, مَا مِن مُصِيبَةٍ تُصِيبُ الْمُسْلِمِ إِلَّا كَفَّرَ اللَّهُ بِهَا عَنْهُ حَتَّى الشَّوْكَةِ يُشَاكُهَا. يعني, there is not any calamity that befalls a believer except that Allah will expiate some of their sins. Even a thorn pricking your finger, small cut like that, pricking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take some sins away with that. And we know from another hadith, a man asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, أَيُّ النَّاسِ أَشَدُّ بَلَاءً, which of the people are tested the most? And he tells him that it's the prophets, al-anbiya. Thumma, then the righteous. And then in varying levels of iman, people will be tested according to the level of religiosity. And that is from the mercy of Allah azza wa jal. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't test you with more than what you can bear. And what's beautiful about that, then it's telling us that whatever Allah tests you with, it's something that you can handle. Because if you couldn't handle it, it wouldn't come to you, it would come to someone else. So then you can handle and you can be patient with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing you with. And Allah will not test you beyond your capacity or beyond your ability. And then one of the things that makes much easier to bear any difficulty or calamity. And why are we talking about patience and calamity specifically? Because the scholar said you need patience upon the obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You need to be patient your entire life, waking up for fajr and putting on hijab your entire life. And how many times we run into people who ran out of patience and they stopped praying or they took off their hijab. So the scholars mentioned you have to be patient upon obedience to Allah azza wa jal. Then you have to be patient in staying away from the haram, because the haram is alluring and enticing and it's beckoning you, especially nowadays, from every corner. So you have to be patient in abstaining from the haram. And the third thing, you have to be patient with the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whatever difficulties, tests and calamities. So when you know that this has already been written, since before the creation of the heavens and the earth, it makes it easier to be patient and to bear through the difficulty. And as we mentioned earlier, you know that no matter what you do, you're not going to change the situation. Like we said, the example of someone, their child dying, may Allah protect your children. But if someone's child dies, if they're patient or not, the child will not come back. The only difference in the outcomes will be, did they receive reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not? With that, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who recognize the truth as clear truth and follow the best of it, and to make us of those who recognize falsehood as clear falsehood and abstain from it. فَاللَّهُمَّ أَرِنَا الْحَقَّ حَقًّا وَارْزُقْنَا اتِّبَاعَهُ وَأَرِنَا الْبَاطِلَ بَاطِلًا وَارْزُقْنَا اجْتِنَابَهُ فَاللَّهُمَّ لَا تَجْعَلِ الدُّنْيَا أَكْبَرَ هَمِّنَا وَلَا مَبْلَغَ عِلْمِنَا وَلَا إِلَى النَّارِ مَصِيرَنَا. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant victory and ease to the Muslims in all parts of the world, Ya Rabbil Alameen. And specifically to the Muslims in India. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant them His ease and His support and His victory. فَاللَّهُمَّ أَبْرِمْ لِهَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ أَمْرَ رُشْدٍ يُعَزُّ فِيهِ أَهْلُ طَاعَتِكَ وَيُهْدَى فِيهِ أَهْلُ مَعْصِيَتِكَ وَيُؤْمَرْ فِيهِ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيُنْهَى فِيهِ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. يَا سَمِيعَ الدُّعَاءِ وَصَلِ اللَّهُمَّ وَبَارِكْ عَلَى مَبْعُوثِ رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ. وَقُومُوا إِلَى صَلَاتِكُمْ يَرْحَمْكُمُ اللَّهُ.